All right, we are here, everyone. We are so ready for some copyright claims. That's right, it's the music show, everyone. We're going to talk about our favorite music from our favorite galaxy. But first, my favorite man has to do my favorite thing. Punch it! Force of UTD Network podcast. I am one of your hosts, Eric Eilerson, and joining me tonight to talk all about Star Wars Muzak is the full cast of rambunctious characters, starting with maybe the most rambunctious of all, Dr. Corey Helton.
What's up, everybody? I'm alive, believe
You're
it or
alive!
Not. After our insane Friday night that I was hungover for a full 48 hours from. That was an intense Patreon event.
Yes, it was. And another person that was at that very event, Charles Hankel, also alive.
Was I there? I didn't know that.
To an extent.
Didn't remember that. No, it was a good time. It was a tough next 24 to 48 hours, not going to lie. I'm sure some of our viewers tonight were not expecting us all to make it here. But here we are.
And
I'm only dead on the inside.
We are, well, hey, we're always dead on the inside, except
there
for the person that is alive on the inside, alive on the outside, and makes me feel something in this cold, dark world, Wes Jenkins.
Welcome, everyone. I'm really excited about this episode. I'm glad we did the music one, because I suggested it many, many months back. And thank you, Eric, for putting that together. Yes, I didn't feel half as bad as y'all did. I felt fine. But I was also drunk after one drink, so I didn't nearly have as many as y'all did.
Well, that helped. Also, I definitely snuck some LaCroix and some water in our Patreon event. But before we get into some details there, I'm going to do something that I never usually do. And first of all, say hi to everyone in the chat. It's been a while since I've said hi at the beginning of the show. I hope y'all are doing great. I can't wait to hear some of your favorite music choices. Already seeing a bunch in the chat from a lot of video games. We got our KOTORs, Republic Commando, Shadows of the Empire, Rogue Squadron from OK Endar. Absolutely all episode long. Throw your favorites in there. And also, while you're at it, like this video and subscribe to the channel. We never say it, but like, it's cool. If you would, that'd be lovely. Share it with your friends so Living Force can grow. But as we've been talking about already, on this past Friday night, we had our long-awaited drunk trivia night, and at least one of those things delivered. We went for 4 hours, a little over 4 hours.
Just a little over, tad over.
Screaming, imbibing, answering questions, and it got messy, my friends. We had a lot of people there. A lot of you folks showed up. Thank you for making us. Is that peer pressure, though? Is this peer pressure that we are endorsing?
Sure, why not? I mean, I'm all for it.
I mean, we'll do it again if you give us enough money. So yeah,
you're
peer
not
pressure.
Wrong.
Everything has a price. That's like my motto.
That's exactly it. But of course, if you missed that event and you are in our Patreon community, there are links in Patreon to see that video that will be up there for all time. But we did have a great time. Our buddy Timothy was our master of ceremonies, kept us going with points. People in the chat had a lot of great comments. We answered some questions, not as many correctly as I thought. I'll be honest, we really missed a lot. We are no Laura from Force Toast over here. We are no Alex Damons. But
did somebody
but it was
win?
A great fun time.
Did anybody win?
Someone did.
The patrons won.
The patrons won.
Yes. If I won,
I got won.
I think we all lost. We all
I'm about to say I definitely feel like I freaking lost. Like
I was surprisingly, I was in the lead like 3/4 of the way through, and yeah. I was just as surprised as everybody else was. But then I ended up coming in last. Through
Did
the lightning
really?
Round, yeah.
Oh, right.
I mean, there was a lightning round? No. When was there a lightning yep. round?
There was a corn yeah. horn lightning round.
Oh, my
point.
God. Listen, minutes. Guys, I went back and watched some of it, and I have bits and pieces of the last 45 minutes. Like, literally, I'm just like, I turned around looking for in my bookshelf. I guess I was looking for Darth Plagueis, and I, like, vaguely remember that. I couldn't tell you who the... who the book was even for until Freddie messaged me in Slack and was like, hey, man, here's my address. And I'm like, oh, I guess that's who the book is right. for. It was just, not good. At some point in that last 45 minutes, too, you guys are like, oh, yeah, I quit drinking forever ago. And I hold up another White Russian.
Oh, yeah,
I'm like,
you made a new one.
Oh, my God, what is wrong with me? This is so not good. And Caitlin was asleep and couldn't help control me. And, yes, I threw up for most of the night, just so everyone is aware. Most intoxicated Dr. Helton has arguably ever been in his life, and it happened live on the internet. Ugh.
Please drink responsibly.
Please drink responsibly. Please.
But we will say, not all of our Patreon goals and events have to do with us just getting completely obliterated, though many will in the future. We're not going to lie. Because we want to go to talk to our Patreon right now. If, besides these shenanigans, our Patreon over at patreon.com/utini or utini.com/patreon features a bunch of extra content from podcasts to other exclusive channels, things like that, exclusive merch. And we want to thank Jason, who just became a monthly patron this week. Thank you so much. And we want to congratulate our Patreon community because this past week, we reached a community goal, our first ever community goal. And what this was, we set a certain number of patrons. So it wasn't a money goal. It was just a number of supporters because we really love having a large community. And we reached our goal. And because of that, we are going to be having a Rogue One watch party very soon. So as opposed to our film commentaries, this will be where us and all of our lovely patrons get together virtually somehow, whether that be on a stream, a Zoom, whatever it is, to just watch Rogue One together. Not recorded or anything like that, just to have a good time watching a movie with friends. So thank you all for getting us there. We'll figure out technical specifications and scheduling, but stay tuned. And of course, now that we've done one Patreon goal, we gotta start talking about the next one. Our next Patreon goal monetarily will be an Attack of the Clones movie commentary. We're getting pretty close. And if y'all loved our Phantom Menace commentary, we have really been on an Attack of the Clones kick recently. Corey, I blame you for this. Oh, yeah. We just keep talking about it.
Suffering as much as I am, please tell me.
That was Friday night. That was Friday night right there. But yeah, so if you have been waiting to join our Patreon and you really want to hear us talk about Attack of the Clones, then never been a better time. So thank you all again for that. And now let's take this moment and segue beautifully into this week's Star Wars Weekly Roundup.
It's the Star Wars Weekly Roundup.
All right, and Star Wars Weekly Roundup, this is where we get you caught up on everything happening in the wide world of Star Wars. You may think, well, the Bad Batch is over now, so there's nothing really going on, right? Does it feel good to be wrong? Because you are. Because this week, we got a trailer, a full trailer, both in Japanese and English for Star Wars Visions. And y'all, this thing was absolutely incredible. We have three screenshots we pulled from here if you want to throw those up. But if you get a second, look at how awesome these look. This is from the Ronin story, or from the duel that is getting the Ronin book. This guy with his lightsaber sheath. I freaking love this. This was one of my favorite art styles in the whole trailer. What about you guys?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I can echo all that. I mean, just the trailer itself was absolutely incredible. There's so much different art styles. It looks like there's going to be a lot of different, like, variations between the stories, but it all feels very, very Japanese, very anime. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, mm-hmm, man, mm-hmm. I'm so jacked.
Like, the movement in the trailer they had, everything is so intense.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not just subtle movements. It's very here and there and now, ha!
Yeah, yeah. Everything's so different. Like, you really can tell when they just flip to a new studio, you know, that did their style of animation. It's going to be really cool to see what lands with certain people. Like, everyone's going to have a different favorite, and that's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, and it's so cool that we're getting that Ronin story with that, because you're right, Charles, we get that background, and then we switch to something like this clip here, which I forget which studio this is, but this was one of my favorite moments. It's, for those of you audio listeners, it's the diagonal shot where the guy is force-holding three stun blasts in front of a bunch of stormtroopers, and I've never seen this. I've never seen someone hold stun blasts with the force.
Yeah. Me either. Like, it looks cool.
There was a lot of force holding of various things.
Yeah, there was. Yeah,
it seemed to be one of the favorite force powers that was displayed in the trailer as a whole.
Yeah, Jacob in the chat says it very well. He says, I love that it looked like Star Wars-themed anime rather than anime-themed Star Wars. And I completely agree. It's letting the artists really explore their medium. Mm-hmm. And I think that was cool. And Angelia asked, do we know if the Vision stories are going to be considered canon? And I believe the answer is, loosely, you'll know when you see it, at least for the book, for Ronin. But I believe, generally, it's going to be, like, loose canon.
Yeah, it's kind of like myths and fables canon, right?
Yeah. That's what I'm getting.
They didn't actually name drop the word legends, and no one has said that because that's not what it's going to be. It's not legends, right? But it is like they did say that they gave the creators essentially permission to tell whatever stories they wanted to in all of Star Wars storytelling, even if it had some conflicting stories with some things that we've seen before. But like it seems like did we recognize any characters in the trailer? I don't think so. Right?
There was a little Boba Fett. There was a little mini Boba Fett at some point.
I've never seen that. That's right.
But yeah, generally it seems like, I mean, even the synopsis we read weeks ago for Ronin is like, seems like a world where the Sith were the good guys and the Jedi were bad. Like, there's certain things that might be different. But then again, until we see it, until we read it, like, we can't really know, right? So this thing was my favorite, just completely wild moment. Audio listeners, can we have, what do you guys, who wants to describe what we're looking at here for our audio friends?
An umbrella lightsaber.
So if you've ever seen an umbrella without the cloth around it, then this is what you're looking at weapon-wise. So the long stem part looks like a staff, and then the outer, like holding of an umbrella, if you will, are lightsabers.
Yeah,
I would say looks like 10 of them.
This artist definitely got poked in the eye with an umbrella. That's all I can say.
You know what it looks like? It looks like if a Star Wars villain was a Dark Souls boss. Like, this is like, I believe you walk into this room and then it unleashes the ember. Because it spins, too, in the trailer.
This is the most impractical weapon I've literally ever seen in all of Star Wars. Like, I absolutely love it. Like, how do you carry this, even? Like, what the heck
with
is this?
With the Force.
It's like, I can't remember if it was a meme or maybe it was a Lego thing, but, like, when Kylo Ren's, like, extra lightsaber blades popped out. It was like actually like a Swiss Army knife or something like that.
Yeah, like the Hanukkah candles. Have you seen that one where it's like all the Hanukkah candles? Yeah.
If Mary Poppins was a Sith Lord.
If
that's the pitch I need. That's all I need. I'm buying it. So I can't wait. Now, did you guys watch both versions of the trailer? Did you watch Japanese and English? Or are you doing one or the other?
I only watched Japanese.
I only watched the Japanese one.
They did an English
dub.
The English dub cast, which we did a write up on our very own McDowell on utini.com. The English dub cast has like Neil Patrick Harris is in there, Alison Brie, George Takei, like Mark Thompson gets a role in there. Like, there's really an all star cast because I know a lot of anime fans don't always love the English dubs. There's a little bit of a stigma that they're not as good, sub versus dub, and I'm not going to pretend to know enough to have a preference, but I think what I'm going to do when it comes out personally, I think I'll watch for my first go through, like, the original Japanese to maybe get the, I don't know, authentic version, if that's even a thing, and then I'll go back and watch the English one as well, because I think it'll be two really cool experiences, and they seem like they'll be short, so very excited for that.
Speaking of, how long do you think they're going to be?
I'm going to guess 7 to 13 minutes. Yeah, I think they're going to be like short. Safe.
Like 10 minutes.
Safe. I hope they're longer than the old Tarkovsky's Clone Wars.
Oh yeah,
I hope
like
they're
2
longer
minutes
than that, but like still, I bet they're, I don't know. There was a lot more variety of content in that trailer that I was kind of expecting to see. And, you know, they originally pitched it being a short thing. I was kind of expecting like a, what was that thing
like
called?
You?
The Women of, oh my God. The Women of Star Wars, that like Star Wars Adventures. Is that what it was called?
Forces of Destiny.
Forces of Destiny. Those felt ultra short, and I hope it's a little bit longer than those.
Yeah. Those are totally 2 minutes long. Two and a half minutes.
And I hope that, like, because they're really putting, I mean, they're putting such work into these things. And that, I mean, in the trailer, the clips, I mean, you got Hat Droid shooting missiles. You got, like, the guy putting his lightsaber together. It's like, gish, 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 jump at your, like, it's like a Gundam lightsaber. I can't wait. So stoked. We will definitely be covering it on Bounty Hunt. We're not sure how we're going to do it yet. We might split it up depending on how long they are. You know, we don't want to like do a 4-hour thing, but stay tuned. Another thing we got, though, was a comic book announcement. We love our comics here. And surprisingly, we're getting a comic shot all about Life Day. Yeah, for real. This is a real thing. We're on the Life Day train this year. If we want to throw up that cover here in a second. It's a collection. Kevin Scott, Justina Ireland, Jody Hauser, and Steve Orlando are all going to write short stories about Life Day. And there's the cover right there for Phil Noto with Old Han and Chewie with the orb. And y'all, look at the Wookiees wearing the red robes from the holiday special.
Look at the cultists in the back.
Yeah, the Imperial Guards that protect Palpatine were actually just Wookiees in Life Day outfits.
Celebrating Life Day! I love Life Day. It should be every day. That would be amazing. But yeah, it's happening. And this will be fun. I mean, I like these kind of collection comics they do. Justina Ireland's writing one about Buriaga. So we get some High Republic Life Day, which would be fun. And I love that they're leaning into it. You know, like we said, we're getting the Life Day Treasury from Kevin Scott and George Mann with short stories. We're getting this comic. Like, you know what? Sure. Why not? Yes.
Why not is the reason, yeah.
Yeah, why not is absolutely the kind of vibe I had about this one. But I do got to say, this kind of got overshadowed by some other comic book news, which if y'all watched the Cosmic Force on Wednesday night, they freaked out about this because Charles Soule kind of broke apart the internet on Wednesday by revealing the new limited series that is coming out this fall. If we want to throw up one of those covers right now, Star Wars Crimson Reign, which is... quote, part two of Charles Soule's Kira trilogy with War of the Bounty Hunters and Crimson Reign. And y'all, this blew my socks off.
Yes. Dude, she looks like a freaking badass, man.
She's jacked. She's
incredible.
Yes. She's scary and she looks evil. Like, is she going to be like a hardcore villain? I kind of hope so. That would be sick.
It'd be amazing. I mean, she's been really cool in War of the Bounty Hunters. If y'all have been reading it, she's been a main... That's where she obviously came back into canon. And we now know this is what happens after War of the Bounty Hunters ends. And we just got a couple covers. This second cover here I especially love because Aphra's on there. Luke is on there in the jacket Han wears in Solo, which I think is like the fourth person to wear it now. and Ren... from the Rise of Kylo Ren series is on there, and Charles Soule has confirmed that the Knights of Ren play a role in this. So, amazing.
Yes.
Like, this is so cool.
Yeah,
absolutely. I'm excited.
I mean, we've been saying that Kira's story is it's been gold since Solo, man. Like,
yeah, for real.
Yeah.
Yeah. How did she get to where she was whenever Han met up with her? When is this one coming out, Eric? Do you know?
And I believe in November is when it starts.
Okay.
Yeah, I believe it's October, November it starts. It's a limited series. I think it's 5 issues. And it's going to show... And this is all forward. These aren't flashbacks. There might be flashbacks to what happened to her, obviously. But it is Kira pressing forward into the canon. So, yeah. I mean, this opens up so much.
Can I just say, I know a lot of us obviously love Solo, Star Wars Story. There's the whole Make Solo 2... movement, right? And like, we may never get that, okay? Just understand that. But if you want to support and show that, you know, you love the character of Kira, that you want more of that story, like, pick this comic up, because they're paying attention to what we're excited about and what we're buying. And, you know, if we back that, all that talk up, all those hashtag Make Solo 2 happens, if we back that up by supporting this series, like, you never know.
Yeah.
Absolutely. A great point. And this is like, you know, if you want to buy like single issues too, single issue numbers mean a lot in the comics world. Like, trades are great and you wait for them. And a lot of people like to wait for them. But if you want to support this character, if you want to support this movement, absolutely. Great point, Charles. Buy those single issues, support your local comic book shop or get them digitally. But of course, if you want the best way to buy literally anything, head on over to the utne.com release schedule where we have this and everything else, including next week's High Republic Tempest Runner, the audio drama. That's right, guys, the 31st. That's next Tuesday. You can get that. You can get the Life Day Treasury, which we already mentioned, on September 7th. And you can get the High Republic Edge of Balance manga on September 7th. Like we're saying, if you like all these Japanese influences we're getting in Star Wars, buy them. vote with your wallets, you know, right? Star Wars stuff is forever. Food and things like that will expire. So where are you going to spend your money? not my best segue. Charles, what do we have for book reviews this week?
All right, book reviews this week. Looks like we have got three different ones. I'm going to take the first one because it's near and dear to my heart. Who wrote this? It looks like Kesha VG123. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing
that. You nailed it.
Reviewed Kenobi by John Jackson Miller. Gave it 4 stars. I have to assume it's on a 4-star scale. and called it the Wild West of Star Wars. And the review goes on to say, initially slow, but picks up its pace after some chapters. This book is full of twists. I was literally on the edge of my seat while reading this. The book shows Kenobi as an old tired traveler named Ben who is just getting used to the new surroundings, and he has a huge responsibility on his shoulders to take care of someone. Action-packed with drama and that good old Wild West touch, this book just never stops to amaze. The unexpected always kept on happening in this read, and it was just phenomenal. If you read Star Wars books, which you of course do because that's why you're here, you have to read this amazing piece of work by John Jackson Miller. Wholeheartedly agree. It is, to this day, one of my favorite Star Wars books of all time. I think it is, I'm going to say it's the best Legends book of all time for me. And that's a pretty glowing review. I'll take it.
I think that is a 4-star scale based on that review. It definitely sounds like it.
Right?
Perfect 4 out of 4.
But the next one, it looks like maybe outdid Kenobi. Wes, you want to take this one?
Can do. So, Ultimate Sauce 8, Red Bloodline.
My favorite Ultimate Sauce.
By Claudia Gray. And this person gave it 5 stars and said, really brilliant. So, a star ahead of Kenobi. So, Gray's characters are great, and this book really delivers as something that makes the sequel trilogy that much better. Characters like Ransom Casterfoe are what lifts Gray a level above most other authors. He offers an awesome parallel to Leia, and he provides a great deep dive into the thoroughly interesting politics of this rich time period. You may not like the sound of politics. Honestly, I didn't either, but this shines a brilliant new light on this undeniably large part of the Star Wars universe, and you shouldn't miss it. The plot is brilliant, as are the characters, so this is a novel that deserves to be read by everyone. It also deserves to be read by me, because I haven't read this one yet. But I like the review, so this is on the top of the enormous list of books that I have to read. And it was also suggested to me to read this during our Books We Haven't Read episode, which I got roasted on.
What have you been doing, Wes? Come on,
there's other stuff happening. But Bloodline keeps coming up all over the place. And I love that review, especially because it does admit, like, a political sounding book doesn't sound as fun. We all remember trade negotiations and contracts and the Phantom Menace crawl. You just gotta stick with it. And the execution is all that matters. Great review.
Steven Kent throws up in his hands.
Sorry, buddy.
All right, Corey, you want to take this last one?
Yeah, I sure can. This review is from Moonflyer, who reviewed The High Republic, A Test of Courage by Justina Ireland, and gave the book 4 stars, said fun for all ages. This book was a fun for all ages read set in the backdrop of the Outer Rim following the Great Disaster. We're introduced to 4 new teenage characters and their droid J6 as they find themselves caught in the middle of the growing struggle between the Nihil and the Republic. On their own, the characters must learn to deal with loss and growing new friendships as they work together to survive and find out what really happened aboard the Steady Wing. This is a fun story for any adult to read mixed in with all the other High Republic books. I look forward to reading it again with my kids sometime soon. Very good.
And you should also consider reading that book before reading Out of the Shadows.
Yes.
Because some of the characters come into play and they matter, and it's a fast read either way. So
yeah, it's definitely a pretty quick read.
Yeah, the High Republic authors definitely love to bring their characters into each book, and why wouldn't you? You know, it's kind of like you get to have your friends and bring them over to your house over and over and over again. So thank you to all of you for those reviews. And if you want your review on this show, look up your book at utini.com, scroll down to the bottom of that book profile page, give it a star rating and review, and we might read it on this very show. And who knows, maybe we'll buy it ourselves. All right. On that, we have a new kind of ad to show you all. So we're going to go to that, and we'll be right back and talk all about our favorite Star Wars music. See you in a second.
Darth Vader lightsaber lamp, and I just like... I just knocked over everything in my office so I could get this into the camera shot. I knocked one of the posters off the wall.
Anderson cover. I have heard the Anderson cover described by some friends of mine as one of their least favorite Legends covers, and I don't totally know why. Maybe it's just because Depa Balaba has this dead stare in the background.
You know what it is?
Emma, what is your art of the week this week?
Yeah, so I don't have anything as dark and depressing as that corpse, but
all right. Thank you to our very own Emma Park for putting that together. A celebration of all the live shows you can find on utini.com, on our YouTube channel as well. So, if you're an audio listener, head over to our YouTube channel, where I believe we'll post the full ad for all the live shows that you can see on our network. All right, fellas, let's do it. Star Wars music. It's real good. All right, everyone, this has been The Living Force. Thank you, though. Wes, you were the one that came up with this episode, like you said, way back in our pitch meeting. So, tell the folks, what made you want to do an episode all about Star Wars music?
Yes, I love the music in Star Wars, but I never realized how much it made a difference until I went to, well, there's two reasons. One of the main reasons was you can tell a character's theme by their music. Like, there's certain music that they have. You can tell, like, when Han and Leia are together, they usually play Leia's theme most of the time. And then you can hear, say, like, Lando's song. Whenever Lando showed up in Rebels, you're like, that's the Cloud City theme, right? And like, that's Lando's theme. But also, I went to the Houston Symphony, and I watched Empire Strikes Back live, with the orchestra playing the music live. And that was an intense musical experience. I suggest it to anyone who's near one of those theaters to actually go check that out if they're ever doing it. I love the music in Star Wars. Love it because once you hear these certain like themes, and you can picture yourself the first time you ever saw it, your favorite moment, all that kind of stuff. And plus, you can play it in the background of anything and have it on. Like, I had a grind for work one time, and I had it for 10 hours. I had like a 10-hour long playback of just all the Star Wars music, and it played through like four or five times. It was great.
Yeah, you just feel cooler when you're doing stuff with Star Wars music in the background, right?
Sure.
You're like, yeah, spreadsheets.
Yeah. You know something I cannot do while I'm listening to Star Wars music is read Star Wars books. I've tried so many times to listen to Star Wars. It's just too epic and emotion filling. Like, just it controls you. You can't.
If it doesn't match, then the book feels weird.
It does. And then you're like, oh, I need a new song. And then you go look at another one. And it's like, oh, no. It's like, it doesn't work. Like,
That's a common
development.
That's kind of a common criticism that I see with some of the audio books. Mm-hmm. They will throw in certain themes that don't match with the characters that are in it. There's a lot of the like Luke's theme and the Binary Suns theme will play with a character that's not a Jedi, which doesn't really quite fit, jive with me.
Yeah, or we could all be wrong based on the chat where, like, our very own Caroline Vincent will put on Star Wars music to read Star Wars books. So if you can do that, number one, please send us your playlists for which books, because I would love to do it correctly. I completely agree. It's so iconic, and it can instantly transport you when you hear just a few seconds of a track, which we're going to do in this episode. We've all, throughout this week, picked a few of our favorite tracks that we're going to share with you all tonight to just kind of say why we love them, what emotions it evokes. But before we do that, guys, I'm going to do a little round robin with you, if I will. Mm-hmm. I'm not asking permission. We're going to do it. And I'm just going to ask you on the spot. We've brought this up a little bit. What is your favorite single Star Wars movie score? Charles, go first.
In your face, Charles, you pick.
Because we talked a lot about this in our Phantom Menace commentary about how is this in the top third? Because it got so hard.
I feel like this is similar to asking you what's your favorite movie, right? It's going to change on the certain day. But I will tell you that the song that I chose for tonight that I knew I immediately had to snag was Battle of the Heroes. And so tonight, that is my answer for favorite all-time Star Wars track.
Nice. Yeah. And that's from, is that that's Revenge of the Sith, right?
Revenge of the Sith, yes.
All right. So Revenge of the Sith. I like that. Wes?
My all-time favorite, which is, it's so hard. Like, saying this is these are our best Star Wars music or our best Star Wars songs is, it's hard to pinpoint. It's hard to say. Because like y'all said, it changes every day. But I can't rate them. It's very hard to rate them.
Yeah.
But having said that, Rey's theme is my absolute favorite and probably always will. Because
I like that.
One of the things that y'all may not know about me, I was in the band when I was in junior high from sixth grade to eighth grade, and I played the trombone, and I was really good.
You played the trombone and you've never made a sound effect for the show before? Like, wah, wah, wah. Like, come on. Yeah. It's like,
I was totally thinking about this. I was like, maybe I should just bring out my trombone and play it for the show.
Oh my God. You should have done that during drunk trivia. Somewhere. Oh my God. That would have been the greatest thing that ever happened.
So Wes, would you say though, Force Awakens as a whole is your favorite? If you had to pick, you get one album, Desert Island, you get Rey's theme, but is it Force Awakens?
See, it might be The Last Jedi. It might be The Last Jedi when I first
if you have to pick
really
the whole
fell
album.
In love with it. Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
Oscar nominated.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's fair.
All right. Corey, how about you?
It's got to be Empire for me, man. Like, there are several. This is how I identified this, right? A couple months ago, I had a whole lot of crap going on in my life just with work and all this crazy stuff was happening. I think it was like March of last year, and it's like peak, was it last year? I came, all my years running together. I guess it was like peak of intern year hell, and it was just awful. And like, I had like a full on panic attack one day, and Caitlin like told me to go listen to some kind of music or something that would help me try to relax. So I picked Star Wars, and I was just shuffling until something emotionally hit me, like that I could relax to. And there were multiple songs from the Empire soundtrack that I like quickly added to a playlist for me to listen to when I was trying to relax. Oh. And I'm like, I think that more than anything is the answer of like, if those songs like spoke to me in a time of panic, then like, I think that has to be it.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite track off of Empire?
I think it's gotta be Yoda's theme on Dagobah. Yeah.
That's great.
I think that was my favorite all time pick.
That's great.
That single song.
Dude, I want to point out real quick, Be Nasty in the chat did answer that Tross is his favorite entire soundtrack.
It's great.
I feel like we rarely hear people, maybe just because it's new, but we rarely hear people put Tross like at the top of their list. That's really cool that someone feels so strongly about that soundtrack.
Yeah. Well, and it's cool because like I think that's probably the one with the most homages, right? Because it's literally pieces of the entire saga. So I think that's a great pick. I'm gonna go. One of the tracks I did not pick tonight is one of my favorites, which is March of the Resistance, because I think Force Awakens might be top to bottom my favorite culmination. And just that moment when the X-Wings come over and to go to Takodana just gets me going. And like you said, we first got Rey's theme. We got March of the Resistance. The Force theme at the end when like Rey tunes in and beats Kylo. Like, you know, it's just so good top to bottom. But you know what? Without further ado, let's jump in and let's listen to some of these things. Y'all, we are gonna hopefully all this music is gonna keep going. We're not gonna get silenced. Remember back in the day when all our streams used to get shut down? We were so young then.
I'm totally expecting SWAT officers to be swinging in through our windows.
Yes.
Right. We're like, hey, you stop! You can't do that.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and acknowledge that we are doing some technical magic today. All right, we've already set up the YouTube video, so it's not being monetized because long story short, we've done everything we can to make sure that the stream stays alive. If for some reason the stream gets cut and it's ended and we all get kicked off, you know, we like Star Wars music. It's been a good show, you know. Go listen to an album or some shit. I don't know.
We'll come back live and we will hum and or whistle the themes so that y'all know. I know what I mean.
You know the one. You know the one.
That's it. All right, much like we did, if you were around for our lightsabers episode, what we did for that one, we went around with our favorites and kind of talked about them. Very similar as this episode. We got our tracks picked up. Corey's got them queued up. We don't know what order he's going to release them in. So, Corey, hit us with that that first track. What are we celebrating right, first?
Let me make sure everyone can hear it. I think everyone can. This first one is Battle of the Heroes from Revenge of the Sith.
But of course...
I love it.
Why am I in a chair right now? It's stupid.
There's something about when there's a chorus. It's what?
Awesome.
Oh, man.
That's one thing the prequel trilogy did was they really brought in the chorus.
Yes,
be emphasized in all of their themes.
The only choral stuff in the originals was Emperor's theme, right? I think.
Mm-hmm.
That yep. kind of deep stuff. But anyways, Battle of the Heroes, like, obviously we are going to hear these songs and we're going to associate with the moment in the film, but mm-hmm. I really feel like even if I didn't know what was going on in the movie, like, you can just feel how yeah. epic it is. You can feel how just powerful that mm-hmm. theme is. Mm-hmm. I mean, it obviously pulls in elements that John Williams always uses, the strong kind of like horns,
right,
the choral element, but like there's just something about this track, man, that it yeah. makes my hair stand up.
Yeah, I
you
totally
know
agree.
One thing I like about Revenge of the Sith and Pitbull in the early 2000s, they both love to bring in the chorus. You know,
all right,
Mr. Worldwide.
It's the culmination that we all remember. It's like
Jason
this is
Derulo.
Yeah. Great pick, Charles. What a hell of a way to get us kicked off. That's
kidding.
Amazing.
Worth it.
All right, we have some, you know, we have some odd picks in here too, which I think is fun, right? Like we didn't just pick like our favorite Star Wars music that's from recognizable scenes. Like we pick various Star Wars music that has spoken to us, I think. And I think this is another good example. This is the trailer music from The Rise of Skywalker. Now, Eric, you picked this one, didn't you?
This is mine. Yeah, this is by Samuel Kim, not even John Williams. But go ahead and play this. This part of it is the most emotional I get from any Star Wars music.
Yeah, I'm going to cry.
Dude.
Turn it off! Turn it off!
Yes, holy smokes.
I'm tearing up, y'all. It's like... Yeah.
Yeah, like, I mean, oh my dude. God. I've said this 1,000 times on this show, but being in a live audience when that trailer played is got to be one of the most memorable moments of my entire life. I mean, it was just...
Yeah.
I mean, the emotional energy was just insane,
yeah.
and I mean, the Princess Leia is like theme is in there a little bit too, right? I think in part yep. of this trailer, like,
well, yeah, and this was the one that came out, like, it was the last one they ever did. It's the last, you know, film Star Wars trailer, and I remember just being in my living room. It's the only trailer I've ever recorded my reaction to, because I was like, oh, this should be it, and I just remember just like being like, oh cool, and that's the part where 3PO says saying goodbye to my friends, and
oh,
Chewbacca
God.
Yells, and then it goes boom, and then it says the story, the saga will end and the story lives forever. And I just yeah. break. It's like, it is the epicness and it is the emotion of like, this is 9 saga films and it's a celebration And regardless of your thoughts on the movie itself, that single moment is one of my favorite Star Wars movies, is that point in the trailer. Right. So, yeah, that is.
100% agree.
We knew it was the end. We knew it was the end, and they really came through with that theme. I think we can all remember where we were when we saw that. I was in a casino hotel room in Nebraska, coming back from a pheasant hunt.
A casino hotel room in Nebraska.
My buddy was on the phone with all our other friends, like, we can't leave yet because Wes has to watch this trailer, and then we can go downstairs and start gambling, but we have to watch this first. I was like, you're damn right we do.
And that's when that ends with Mark Hamill saying the Force will be with you, and then it's Carrie Fisher's voice saying always.
Always. Yeah.
And then we
Wes's friends were leaving to go gambling, and Wes was like, taking one last look, sir, at my friends as they walked away.
Oh, man. All right. Oh, so we're two in, and I'm a mess. So let's just keep going. Why not?
All right, here we go. We have a lot of them here. This could very well end up being a longer show.
This is great.
This is the droid invasion and the first appearance of Darth Maul.
Yes. Maybe. Yes. Oh, man, the snare and the cymbals.
No.
God. My marching band soul is being activated.
It's hard not to hum this one.
I know, it so is.
It's so catchy. So catchy.
Yes, Harris, Battlefront 2. This is Battlefront 2 music right
here.
Sure.
It totally is. It absolutely is.
Whose was this? Yeah.
This was one of mine as well. I think because I gave up one of mine, and then I pulled this one in, I think.
Thank you, Charles.
This one... a lot of my picks are from the prequels, and maybe that's just because I'm most partial to those as films, but like this one, like I can feel it in my 6-year-old self's chest, like in the movie theater. Like I don't know. It really takes me right back to the Phantom Menace, and I don't know. I feel like this song in particular is actually a little bit underrated. It's not like one of the first ones that comes to mind, but when classics. You hear it, it's so identifiable.
I know. Yeah. It's going to be in my head now for like the next hour. Like,
yeah.
You're welcome.
It's very distinct that it's for the villains. It's for the bad guys. This isn't for the good guys theme. You can tell because of the horns and the way that the lower tones are doing that. Dun, 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 dun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is the prequel's Imperial March, really.
Yeah. I would say that.
And Andrew makes a great point in the chat that there are definitely hints of the First Order theme within that. Like, Williams is very good at making sure the villains have, like you're saying, Wes, the lower brass, and like the good guys get a lot of strings and like trumpets and higher brass. Like, it's very classic music theory, and it works because he seeds it differently in each film, but they all work together. I love it. Williams is very good.
All right.
Who would have thought?
He's good. He's really good.
Indeed, two Oscar nominations, I think.
All right.
Is that all?
Oh.
All right, sorry.
What we got next?
The dog was barking. All right.
Oh, no, I figured.
So, I admittedly didn't pick music until right before the show. You guys were reading book reviews and stuff, I picked a couple of surprises to throw in here for you.
Oh, yeah,
that I remembered
right.
as we were doing.
Dog.
I'm not going to tell you what this one is. I want you just to get ready to cry like a little baby. All right, you're
okay.
ready?
Okay. Oh, no. Try me out. Is this your father would be proud of you?
This is Ahsoka Leaves from the Clone Wars. Dude, my skin is crawling right now. It's so rich.
I wouldn't have known it if you didn't say it.
Kevin Kiner, man.
It's so good. I think is this the main riff right here? Man,
Clone Wars. Yes, Angelia. Clone Wars is some of the best music ever.
Yes, it's not even a question. I think
goosebumps right now.
I know. I'm telling you, these strings are like the richest in all of the Clone Wars. It's so good.
Yeah.
You can like see them out of the terrace.
Dude, I'm misty-eyed. It's so freaking powerful when like Anakin says to Ahsoka, I know what it's like to want to leave. And she like, oh, God, dude, I'm going to cry on the freaking screen. It's ridiculous. Like, I'm telling you, the music is so powerful, and it's what sets the tone for the entire show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I love that we have this here because it's Williams followed by Kiner. Like, the amount of composers that have worked in the same universe and elicited the same emotions with similar tactics is just spectacular because they are very different, but...
very good pick. You jerk.
Such a good pick.
Yeah, I know. All right. Sorry, I just remembered it randomly. All right, all right.
What's
here's
another
a,
one we got.
Here's a much, much lighter one. This is Flying with Chewie from Solo Star Wars Story.
This is my first pick.
Well, I'm not going to call you that.
Oh, man. Also a good one. Dude, good choice.
Dude, this one right here with the French horn right here. That is tone at the end. It's just, it's such levity. It's John Powell, How to Train Your Dragon, man.
Yeah, it
and
is.
And like, Solo is.
There's some Tarzan
underrated
vibes in there, maybe a little bit. Like, I love it.
And it's because it's after they just like failed the mission, but they got Chewie back. Or no, they got off of, not the mission, they got off of Mimban.
The Mud Planet.
And they got their shower, and it's just Han and Chewie meeting.
Yeah.
That's what it was. They just got done taking a shower, and they got out and air dried together.
Yeah.
Y'all not list this every time you get out of the shower?
Every day. But this was like, so How to Train Your Dragon is also one of my favorite film scores of all time, and you could totally hear it in this track and the whole movie. John Williams did the theme for Han in Solo, but the whole thing done by John Powell, I think, is in my maybe top two, if not my number one, Star Wars scores on any given day. I absolutely love it. And that's the one that is the levity of Star Wars. That's adventure and friendship to me is that song.
Absolutely.
All right. This next one is from Wes, and I forgot that you did this, but here you go.
What?
Bring it to me.
Oh my God, look at it.
The audio listeners, there was a video component to this. Wes, so what was that?
Oh my God. I'm not going to lie. I'm 100% going to go back and listen to that entire thing later.
the theme itself is the Imperial March, one of the most iconic themes in Star Wars history.
Of course.
I could not leave it off. Could not leave it off. But I put the original in there as well. I tried to find like the super heavy metal version where like you can't listen to like the guy's voice. He's like raw, 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 but I didn't do that. But yes, the Imperial March, the ultra villain theme to put in any, if anybody heard that theme, they know exactly what it's from, kind of thing. My buddy used to have that on as his he would have this on his phone as his ringtone for when his dad called him.
I think everyone should at least have one person that at one point the Imperial March was their ringtone.
Yeah.
So
it's
great.
So,
also,
it's so iconic. It really is.
Yeah, really. I want to say, speaking of like alternate Star Wars music, which I guess we don't talk a ton about, one of my most listened to Spotify playlists is 100% the lo-fi Star Wars playlist.
Oh, yeah.
The most calming thing. If you want to read Star Wars books to music and you kind of want Star Wars, but you can't focus like we can, lo-fi Star Wars, I tell you, it's the greatest thing in the world.
This was also in the Family Guy episode when they're in the elevator and they play the elevator music part of the Imperial March when it's like, do.
So
I
wish
it was in Solo, wasn't it playing like for the
in Solo,
ad,
yeah,
like for the
it was
recruitment ad
recruitment.
In Solo.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
in
like
a
the
major
only,
key.
Yeah, so it's like the only song that was besides, I guess, like Cantina and like Jabba's Palace, like Max Rebo Band, that's also a song in the universe.
Yeah, where characters inside the movie could hear it.
Yep.
So, cool. I wish I could play it for you. I don't think I can. On my phone. So, I'm not sure if you guys know this. You can control like the buzz pattern on your phone, like the vibrate pattern. Like, and set your own tones. And my vibration pattern on my phone when it's on silent is the Imperial March. Yeah, that's what it does. Like, that's how it vibrates.
That's hilarious.
I set that so long ago. Like 8 years ago or something like that, when they first added that feature to the iPhone. It's been that ever since. And like, I've had to remake it several times when I've lost it, but like, I can't not have that. It's just what it is. It's so recognizable too. I can hear my phone vibrating from a different room. It's fantastic.
Ooh, here's one. I don't know what your order is, Corey, but for our next track, Neptune in the chat brings up a great one. We haven't talked about yet, but I feel like we have something, right? The Rogue One soundtrack.
You mean like this? This is another one of the picks that I secretly did right before the show.
It's so good. Michael Giacchino had a month to do the whole score. That's insane. Incredible. Incredible.
I know. Especially how it goes epic and then gets quiet and like,
yeah,
it's really, really good.
I love the theme for Rogue One as well. I didn't put that in mind because it was hard to find a good one, but it, like, just the like, bum, 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 bum.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's so simple. But it's so good.
All right, here's
the really silly font.
I know, it's true. I love it. It's called Trajan. I've used it occasionally.
Is the font?
The font is called Trajan. Yeah, it's an Adobe font, actually. Yeah, it's like a real font. It's not like a fake Star Wars font, but whatever. Anyway, here you go. Another one of my picks.
Classic.
Oh man, such a classic. I get giddy listening to this song. It makes me so happy.
You can't not.
I think there was one of the aliens in the cantina who was like, man, I hate this song.
That's like from the, I think it's the Family Guy special, isn't it? Where he pretends. It's the guy, what's his name? Figurin' Dan? Is that what
Figurin' Dan
is?
And the modal nodes?
Yeah. They finished the song and he's like, is there any requests out there? And then he pretends to throw his voice. He's like, play that same song again. And he's like, okay, all right. We go.
Well, and I think the cantina theme is also so interesting because it is kind of one of those things that really defines Star Wars. Like, it's one of the first active songs you hear. It's they're in Mos Eisley. Mm-hmm. They're on Tatooine. Like, it is so important. That song didn't work. That's where we meet Han Solo. That's where we like learn about the Millennium Falcon. Like, that song sets it up. And if that doesn't work and draw you in, you don't care about the foundation of Star Wars.
Yeah. Every time I hear the beginning of that song, I just remember that alien with his head that pops up right in the beginning. Yeah. Just like,
yes.
Oh, man.
Oh, perfect. Great choice, Corey. Oh, my God. What a pull.
All right, here we go. This is the finale from Empire Strikes Back.
So this was one of my choices, and I specifically chose it because it pulls in the Han and Leia theme, and it's the best version of it, I think, from the whole film. And I can see this scene in my
head. I can see it, yeah.
Same here. There's that Leia theme, man.
My so God. Good.
We should also talk about that for a minute. Of them staring out of the viewport, right, at the stars, and Luke just got his hand, and like, we all just watched that moment in our head, okay, with that song.
Yeah.
But like, it's so cool.
Lando has been redeemed. Him and Chewie are flying off into the distance. Yeah, it's so good.
Exactly. But it's so cool how all the movies, you just get that like that horn blast, and it's just right into like the main theme. Like,
it's like the last roller coaster because we all go. And you're like, oh my gosh, it's a Star Wars movie!
Play it again.
All right. Keeping in line with Empire, here is Yoda's theme, which we already talked about earlier. But this is another really good one. That was a horse.
Oh, you're making a mess. I got that trivia question right, by the way, audience.
This is the most magical and ethereal the Force ever feels for me.
Oh, man, it's so good. My skin's like crawling again. I'm getting goosebumps again. Yeah, like, this is the only other song so far that's done it for me. I'm telling you, it's this album is like when he moves the X-Wing, right? Uh-huh.
Also in The Last Jedi.
Yep.
That's right.
Brings it up out of the water. Basically the same theme, right?
Yeah, it is. Oh, yeah, nice, yeah. Charles.
Yep. Yeah, you go repping the Yoda shirt.
Yeah.
Both times brings the X-Wing up out of the water.
The Force really is strings, isn't it? The more we love this, it's like, that's what it is.
Yeah, it is.
Rarely brass with the Force.
It's hard not to think of all Yoda's fantastic quotes from this section of the movie with the phone
too. Yeah, yeah, yeah. This entire song is really good, especially the most epic little riff of this, where it's that same little introductory riff, but it's like really, really epic. It's when he's pulling it out of the swamp or whatever, and it like really builds, and there's a peak, and
ba-dum,
I don't know. I know. It's so epic. Yeah. I've kind of made fun of that song a little bit, I've made fun of that scene a little bit, being in Rise of Skywalker. Yeah, and I feel like it was a little overdone, perhaps, but I completely agree with the choice of music. And
yes.
Very cool to do the throwback music choice for that scene. And then they also use Yoda's theme again in the Last Jedi, when Yoda shows up for the first time, and it's playing that really epic music when Yoda has some of those really, really good quotes from The Last Jedi of like, he's like, failure, yes, failure, most of all. That is the true burden of masters. And it's just like, shit.
Page turners were
perfect.
I know. It's so good.
Also, I think I'm looking at the chat right now. We got a lot of love for the victory song from Phantom Menace. Is that on our list? Did someone pick that?
That's one of mine. It's Augie's Great Municipal Band.
All right, here
yes.
we go.
We create that, Soulja Boy.
The one whistle guy.
Because a drum major Gungan, 100%.
Peace.
It's like, hey, you dumb adult, you're here for Star Wars movie in 15 years.
That smile over to Anakin. She's like, yeah.
Call me in 10 years, buddy. I don't know. I might be a little mischievous.
I know. Then Boss Dance is like.
Although, Neptune makes a great point. Part of this song, if you do slow it down, it's the Emperor's theme.
That was one of the points I wanted to bring
up.
I think
it's not.
But it's you have to move it to a minor key as well
and
for
it
to
down.
Actually be the Emperor's theme. But there are videos you can find.
It's Palpatine's
on YouTube
actual music
where they actually do it and you can hear it. Yeah. So I think that is one of the coolest musical facts of any of the Star Wars movies that they've made.
Yep.
That in that moment of absolute triumph at the very beginning of the saga, if you're talking episode wise. Mm-hmm. Palpatine's still in there, dude. Like, he's already
well, who's winning
the
most
for his plan.
It's Palpatine.
Wait, was he the Phantom Menace? Hold on.
Yeah.
Wes.
Hold on, bro.
Nice. No. Wait, was Luke the New Hope?
Spoiler alert if y'all haven't seen these movies. Sorry.
More like the rays of Skywalker. Anyway.
All right. Here you go, Wes. Speaking of your really bad joke, here you go. This is another fantastic one. I think this is one of your picks.
This is the reason John Williams came back to Star Wars.
Don't talk to my team.
Oh God, it's so good.
Wow.
It's so good, dude.
I know.
Jeez.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Ray's theme.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cannot.
Wow. My God.
It's basically a entire crescendo of a song up until like the entirety of the song is a crescendo. It's great. I love it. It's very subtle, like in the beginning, and it has those flute sounds, and then those I mean, when I first heard this song, especially when I was watching The Force Awakens, I was like, damn it, this is gonna be my favorite character, this is gonna be my favorite theme. I love this. It really hit hard for me. Mm-hmm. So
I don't know what it was.
It was like, I mean, I loved all the Star Wars themes before this, but this one here just resonated with me somehow.
Yeah. John Williams say this was by far his favorite song that he created for the sequel trilogy? Yeah. He gave Daisy Ridley like something. Have you remember what that was?
The original sheet music for
That's right. She gave him the original sheet and Daisy cried. I think when he gave it to her,
I would have an aneurysm. Incredible. Yes. It was beautiful. And he said, I think he said to JJ or someone, he says, once he saw footage of Rey, he's like, I need to come back for the sequels because I don't want anyone else to write music for that character except me. Because he heard what it was in his head. He's like, this is what it has to be.
Yeah.
And Caroline in the chat, it is such a great introduction to her character because there's no dialogue for Rey. The first things we get is that theme before she says a word.
Yeah. Yep.
That's true. Ugh. She slides down on that piece of metal to this song.
That was the moment when I knew that movie was going to be very true to the originals to me. Yep. I don't know, something about the pacing and how she just like showed when she pops her head up and she's wearing that goofy head dress thing with the goggles and and the music starts and I'm just like, it was
and
good.
The way she like chews the green stuff when she's wearing the helmet, like
yeah, exactly.
Like, it's just like there's a levity to it.
And
he also keeps it like, well, that's such a great pick, Wes, because Williams just sprinkles that throughout the entire saga. Every time Wes shows up, when she's going dark, it gets more intense during the fight. Whenever the Force fills her, it's the Force theme mixed with Rey's theme. Like, Star Wars,
very overpowering.
So good.
That goosebumps, man. Damn it.
I know. It's so funny how some of that music really speaks to you like that. This is probably also your pick, too. This is the Jedi Steps in the finale. Is that also yours, Wes?
Yes.
It's also some of Rey's kind of music.
Yeah. It's so light.
Because this was when we first, we knew where she was walking.
Yeah.
We knew where she was and who she was going to find. And this music helps us like get to that point, get up to Luke Skywalker. And we're just like,
because we just had like this huge high of, like, we won the battle. And in most Star Wars movies, that would be the end. And we leave in that crescendo. But they're like, no. One more thing.
It's such a long buildup too. I love how long the buildup it is.
Because she has to take all the stairs. They're like, nope. You know what's coming. You gotta earn this. And then.
Standing there with his back.
All of our faces were melting right about now.
Yeah.
Like it's still going. The crescendo is still going. We're not done yet.
Iconic horns, French horns.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jacob, I also need to go to Skellig Michael and play this song as I go to the top. I will play it like 12 times in a row because I'm not as fit as I used to be. But it'll take me a hot minute.
Charles first selected that, and then I had to snatch it from him. I said, no, sir, no. That one is mine. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Charles. I appreciate it.
It's always a good sign if we're fighting over the tracks.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Oh.
All right, here's another iconic one. This is one of mine. You cannot have a discussion about Star Wars music without Binary Sunset.
All right.
It's not possible.
I'm ready.
You gotta...
Wes.
Yes!
I didn't have the fan on.
Okay, how many kids chose to play the French horn in band purely because of this song? I don't think it's not a small number.
I agree.
Oh. Is it close to perfect? I mean,
yeah.
I mean, I think it is.
Even the after bit. I love it.
Yeah. After all we know about Luke's journey now, too, anytime in a trailer or in one of the YouTube fan made things, when they show Luke staring off into the binary sunset, I just lose it.
When you imagine, like, when they filmed that, they just had Mark Hamill just do the lookup. So can you imagine being George Lucas being like, all right, so let's see the first go of the score. And then you see John Williams did that with the look, and you're like, oh, cool, this movie's going to make $100 million in a week.
That's a good point.
The moment.
That's a good point to bring up, too, Eric, because, you know, we've all watched the behind-the-scenes documentaries, and, like, the choice of John Williams went against, like, everything of the times, right?
Yep.
Like, Star Wars as a film and the themes of, like, happiness, like, not, I don't know. It was just very, a very different choice. And to have a classical theme, like, classical music was not what anyone else was doing.
No, nobody else was doing it. It was all it was early synth music and, like, it was late popular, disco stuff. And
popular music had made it into movies to where they saw that it was bringing in incredible amounts of revenue from Easy Rider. Easy Rider was the first one to do it, and they were like, holy crap, look at all this music we're getting from, like, Steppenwolf that we put into a film. It's crazy. So they everybody kept reiterating that with the pictures after the 50s.
For all we know, the movie would have failed without John Williams.
We have no idea.
Yeah.
Well, and Angela, you make a great point. Like, the older I get, the more I relate to Luke looking at the binary sunset. I think that's exactly it, because we think about, you know, the hero's journey, right? The call to adventure is such a point. And I think Luke looking at this, at the suns with this music, is, if you look in the dictionary, the call to adventure from that point on. Like, it describes it, I think, more perfectly than any other level of Campbell's work.
Mark Hamill made it look like he was actually listening to that music, but he was listening to nothing. He was like, God, it's hot out here.
It's hot. It's so Tunisia's sandy.
I hate sand. God, I hate sand. All right, here we go. Let's bring it back down a little bit for the evening. Here's
This is Bury the Dead
from the Clone Wars.
This is one of mine.
Dude, this one also gives me chills.
Season 7, last thing we hear. Just Ahsoka just, like, looking out at all the helmets.
This was rough to watch.
It was,
man. And it was a freaking cartoon.
I just can barely watch this past week.
I think earlier we mentioned there's similar note progressions to Ahsoka leaves. In this, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Oh.
He's like,
I'm sorry, everyone, that I did this. This is on me.
Dude, you suck, man.
Yeah. And it's just such a moment of, like, Ahsoka's looking out, and also everyone watching at that moment was watching the Clone Wars end. Like, we had watched this series for 7 seasons for over a decade of our lives, and we were watching the last frames of the show we loved go away. And it was like,
We almost didn't get that.
Yeah, we didn't for
they had
crazy.
To bring
7
Clone
years,
Wars 6 years for us to get that.
Oh. Let's complain some more. See if we can get season 8.
Let's complain.
Yes. Oh yeah.
Speaking of Ahsoka falling, that's why Anakin kill all these younglings real fast.
You can hear in the background the marching.
Of the drums.
So this is the Jedi Temple march when Anakin is leading the clones up into the Jedi Temple, and he's getting ready to slaughter everybody. And so, like, that beginning is like,
it's so scary.
Let's listen to that part again. All right, where is it? It's here. It's 2047. Here we go.
42.
Listen to the marching, because I think you're right. I know it's got the marching undertone there. I know.
It's great. Because once you saw that, you were like, Anakin has bought 100% into this, and he's coming to slaughter.
I know.
And he's got an army behind him, and he's ready to take this. He's like, he got this whole army behind him. He's like, all right, I think I can take these kids now.
It's like,
you
it's
guys
just
take
so...
the adults, I'll take the small children.
It's so weird because William somehow makes it hopeless. Like it is a hopeless moment, and you just have to sit and experience the music and experience the slaughter as an audience member because you can't stop it.
Yeah, it's got the subtle tones of, well, not the subtle tones, but it's got a similarity.
Subtle about
definitely,
that.
Definitely similarity to the Imperial March that they kind of wanted to add in there.
Yeah, you know, you also have to think about too. We've never really talked about this before, but like, you know, the Clone Wars are in full force right now, and there's like not that many Jedi in the temple, right? Like most of them are kind of spread about. So like, what a perfect time to attack is like when they're all totally spread out. And man, it was dark.
And that's why it's important. That's why it's important.
It sounds like a plan.
The beacon telling all the Jedi to return to the temple. That's why it's so important.
Yeah, that's right.
Hello, this is Obi-Wan Kenobi. The Jedi Temple has fallen.
Stay the hell away. Hey, don't come back here, man!
It's a trap!
It's a trap!
Ian in our chat, buddy, other than mentioning, of course, his love of the holiday special music, also just mentioned Ludwig Göransson's score for Mandalorian. And I know that was one of my choices
as
well.
Dude, that's the next one I have pulled up right here.
This one's episode one. Talk about crescendos. This was at the end of the first episode. This is when I knew this show was gonna be a hit. So hold on, here it comes.
When that.
Ba-da-da! Ba-da-da-da!
It hits so hard, I love it.
I will dance to this in a nightclub.
Dude. And I think the track is called, like, You Are a Mandalorian, right? And I'm like, yes, I am, Luke!
I am!
Yes, I am!
I am, Mom!
Like, it is, yeah, dude, Ian, dude, 100%, it's so unique, because it's unlike anything else in Star Wars, but it's completely Star Wars.
So, as a sidebar, so he was the composer for Creed, was that it?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay, so,
And Black Panther, I believe.
My all-time favorite soundtrack is Rocky, and Bill Conti is the composer of that. And so there's Rocky vibes to that, just from the horns that are used in that.
Oh yeah.
In the Mandalorian soundtrack, but Ludwig incorporated that from Bill Conti stuff into Creed, and then so that I'm sure part of his composer or as part of his music was looked at in Creed, and we're like, you know what, this would be perfect for the Mandalorian. So it all kind of trickled down.
Also, if you've never watched the gallery behind the scenes of The Mandalorian, watch one with him on it because he shows how many recorders he bought for The Mandalorian. He has a stupid amount of, like, you know those things you played in elementary school? But they're, like, 18,000 times as big.
Yeah, the bass recorder is the instrument
recorder.
It's a bass recorder, which is, like, why the hell does that exist? Like,
There's Mandalorian. So cool.
There's also a moment in that documentary, the behind-the-scenes stuff, where he, like, plays the theme for, I think it was for like Filoni on his phone for the first time. And even hearing it first time on the phone, he was like, yo, that bops. Like, this is, we gotta use this.
God, it's just so, so incredible. And I love too, because we talked earlier, you know, about using Williams as a risk. I mean, using Ludwig to do a whole score for a Disney Plus show was a risk. They didn't know if this was going to work. There weren't original Disney Plus programmings. Like, I know it feels like we're in it now, but way back when, like, what, 2 years ago, like, Mandalorian was the biggest risk Star Wars had taken in years. And the fact that they respected it enough to pay to hire him and get this brand new score from a guy who's a hot composer in Hollywood right now.
It was definitely amazing. It was definitely a calculated risk, though, because they had, you know, Filoni and Favreau on there. It's kind of hard to miss.
They had the money. Disney money. What a wonga.
All right. The last two that I have pulled up here. We're getting some chat requests.
Yeah, well, there's some honorable mentions as well, for sure.
That's true. Last two I have pulled up here. This is one of yours, Wes. It's Black Thunder by The Who. Is that how you say this? Hugh by The Who?
The Who?
Is that what?
The
I don't
Who?
Know.
It's
spelled A-W-H-U. Anyway,
is H-U.
Should I Fall in Order?
Oh, Fall in Order.
This is an actual band, but this is when Cal Kestis gets put into the fighting pit. I forgot what planet it was on.
You have to
face like a barrage of like insects, and then there's two huge like villains and machines that you have to bite. And this music is perfect because you get your ass kicked for an hour until you can beat it. And you hear this in the background. You're just like, I gotta play again. But this is always playing on like repeat over and over. But you walk into the Jedi like fighting, you walk into the fighting pit and it's nothing. And then you hear that, well, why don't you try against these? And then you hear this music start playing, and you're like, oh, you know, something's about to happen.
You know, this kind of sounds like what I imagine Rec Punk to sound like.
From High Republic.
But you have to play it at this volume only. Like, it has to be very loud. You cannot even hear yourself think, basically.
Also, guys, I just want to let you all know, watching and listening, I just hit my move goal on my Apple Watch because I've just been, like, rocking out. I have my workout for the day.
I had to throw that in there as my honorable mention. Couldn't not.
All right, and this is the last honorable mention that I had. Not me, but like we have in here is this is the Marauders song from Solo, because it's like your Marauders Arrive, because it's so weird.
Yes.
And this is a fantastic one.
Oh, on their space motorcycles.
Yep.
I forgot. There's a trivia fact about the choir on this. It's like it's younger kids.
This bit right here.
That's incredible.
I don't think I've ever noticed that.
Oh man, now I gotta remember that trivia fact. Excuse me, while I Google.
It keeps going. Like, I mean, it doesn't get higher and higher every time, I think. Yeah, like this.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. It makes the Marauders feel so like alien and imposing, because
yeah,
like the music feels so different and you kind of don't understand it and you don't understand the characters yet.
Right. You're like, they're bad guys, right? It kind of the kind of music is kind of counteracting that a little bit.
Yeah, yeah, that features a 36-voice Vanya Moneva Bulgarian choir.
Wow.
That was recorded at Abbey Road Studios.
It's a strong
Nicole
people.
Is Bulgarian.
It's a strong
people.
Is
she in the choir?
She's not in the choir. Her mom actually was in a traveling Bulgarian choir for a while. So
yo,
it was this one. I don't have to ask.
Is she also an Olympic weightlifter? Bulgarians are really good at that.
Yeah, I absolutely love those. Yeah.
All right. That one's last one by request of the chat is the classic Across the Stars, also known as the love theme from Attack of the Clones. I do have to say, for some reason, like randomly, you know, you have songs like that you wake up in the morning and they're just stuck in your head, like and you don't know why. You're like barely even consciously awake, but the song is there and you're humming it.
I want it that
there.
Way by the Backstreet Boys.
Good.
All right, Wes.
Good.
That all day turn. Today.
this song is frequently that song for me for some reason. I don't know why. I think it's just, I guess I have Attack of the Clones like burned in my brain, but like I get this stuck in my head a lot. It's weird. I don't know. So here we go.
I've heard a lot of people like walk down the aisle to this, and I'm like, ooh. I get it.
I should have thought of
right?
that.
Right?
Damn
it's
it.
It's just throwing that in the back of the head.
Just get remarried. I mean to Caitlin, not to somebody else.
All right. Listen to that. I wonder if George was like, hey, John, what does love mean to you? Go. because this is kind of like John Williams is so good at writing feelings as music. And there's a little bit of fear there. You hear those notes. There's like a little bit of like uncertainty.
Could you do that? Could you live a lie?
Yeah, man. Like, sure. That was the original line.
I just want people to know we're doing it.
For the last moment I laid eyes on you, I deeply, truly loved you.
This could fit easily into the original trilogy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You're training to be a Jedi, and I'm a senator.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Anakin, don't say things like that.
Anakin, you're breaking my heart. All right, that's a different song, but still, so many bad lies, but a beautiful song, nonetheless. Yeah,
beautiful song, an absolutely beautiful song, and like, I think it just, like, no songs that we played were like the same in this. Like, there were so many tracks.
But somehow they are all related. Like, they all go into each other, and it's just, I don't know, it's magic music theory, Star Wars. I suppose. Yeah, that is the common element.
That's true.
All of the songs that we played today have been on a Star Wars podcast. That's what they have in common.
That's right. Well, I think it's so fun that it's like, you know, we've shown things on this episode from movies, from animation, from live action TV, from video games, from like every part of Star Wars, regardless of the story that it's telling or how it's made, has incredible music. And I think that George deciding from the beginning in the 70s that was a key part of the whole franchise, like, it doesn't have the staying power if every product doesn't have that kind of music.
You know, it really is crazy how almost 50 years were going on in Star Wars, and like,
oh God,
just how much music there is. Like, we played like 10 seconds of like 20 different tracks today, and we like barely even scratched the surface. Like,
oh, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
There's like probably several hours of Star Wars music. Like, for real.
Some of these, like the themes and the music, they tell the story better than like the acting on the screen does. Mm-hmm. It helps you understand what's going on and the emotions that they're feeling, not just like tears going down somebody's face, because who cares about that?
When Last Jedi came out, I know there was an extra, I don't know if it's still on Disney Plus, but there was an extra for Last Jedi that was a score only version. And I think you still get it on the DVD, where it literally, there's no dialogue or anything. It just plays the Williams score, and you can just watch Last Jedi with the score only, and you get the complete film.
Holy crap. Oh. Cars in the chat says the canon complete available music is 38 hours and 2 minutes.
Jeez.
Is that real? Oh my God.
Oh yeah, it has to be.
38 hours of Star Wars music? Holy smokes. That is nuts.
Could you have that like built into your house and then have like speakers throughout, like on your ceiling throughout your house, and just have it playing?
And you're just like, Sonos,
different song.
It'd only
be cool for a week, and you're like, I heard this.
I get this.
It's too much.
But I'll tell you what, as we're getting ready to get out of here, I want to ask all y'all watching and all y'all listening, like, let us know in the Discord, on Twitter, anywhere in your life, what's some of your favorite Star Wars music and why? What's some of the themes you haven't thought of in a while? Like, we didn't touch Rebels. We didn't touch KOTOR. We didn't touch like a lot of other things that have just phenomenal music. And just, I hope that if you need some extra music in your life, you throw on some Star Wars, and just, I don't know, love it, appreciate it. Guys, any other last tracks that we didn't get to?
I went through Rebels to see if I could find one that I enjoyed, and I was listening to Kanan's theme, and I didn't like it very much. then as I progressed...
All right.
And then I found
what a wreck.
Harris theme is really good. Harris theme
is phenomenal.
It's noticeable too, because you can hear it, and when they play it in Rebels throughout, especially after Kanan's death. Spoiler alert, Jesus, sorry.
Yeah, that's terrible.
Yeah, and Harris theme in Bad Batch was really good too. That was probably the most standout music to me out of that entire show.
Oh, yeah.
That was very
Bad Batch had great music.
It had little bits of Leia's theme in it too, which was interesting. So I don't know. There's a lot of really, really great stuff. Like if I went back through the soundtracks, like,
sorry,
like, for real, and really try to pick everything, there would be a lot more I would have to pull out for a show like this.
Yeah. just have it on the background. And finally, not a sponsor, if you have Spotify and you play it on your computer, whenever you play Star Wars music, the little progress bar turns into a lightsaber and you can pick which lightsaber you want it to be.
Yeah.
It's so dumb, but it makes you
use
Spotify.
Pick the lightsaber? No.
Click the lightsaber.
No.
It changes.
Is that a thing?
I didn't know that part, actually.
Yeah, you can make it. They have Rey's, Mace, Ahsoka's whitesabers, Luke.
They have Mace on there?
They have Mace's lightsaber.
You know why it's on there?
Because
it's
purple?
Because he's
still alive.
Oh, my God.
He's still alive. All right, folks. Last thing. Heads up, 2 weeks from tonight, we'll be doing our Out of the Shadows roundtable. So you have 2 weeks to finish that book if you have not yet. And we will see you next week because, my friends, that will do it for this week's episode of The Living Force. If you already support us on Patreon, thank you so much. We appreciate it dearly. We hope you enjoyed the Patreon event. We can't wait for our next one. A special thank you to Cheryl Bell, OK Endar, Patrick Ortiz, and Carl Sander on our Jedi High Council, and Elizabeth Cloutier, Jason Mitchell, Freddie C, and Sally and Chris Eilerson and our Alliance High Command for their amazing support. You can find us on Twitter. I'm at Eric Eilerson. Corey is at Doc Star Wars MD. Charles Zetsy Hankel. Wes is at Boss Wes. A special thank you to Matt Davenport, our amazing editor, Ryan, our graphic designer extraordinaire, and Wes, our producer and community manager. Thanks to Corey, Charles, and Wes for podcasting with me. Thanks to all of you in the chat for your music recommendation and for hanging out tonight. And as always, may the Force be with you.